On this edition for Saturday, September 5th,
the Rochester Police Department has declared this an unlawful assembly.
Nationwide protests continue into the Labor Day weekend. The staying power of election disinformation. And in our signature segment, with COVID-19 restrictions easing in some places, the arts are again taking center stage. Next on PBS NewsHour Weekend.
PBS NewsHour Weekend is made possible by Sue and Edgar Wackenheim III, the Anderson Family Fund, Bernard and Denise Schwartz, the Cheryl and Philip Milstein family, Barbara Hope Zuckerberg, Charles Rosenblum. We try to live in the moment to not miss what's right in front of us. At Mutual of America, we believe taking care of tomorrow can help you make the most of today. Mutual of America Financial Group, retirement services and investments. Additional support has been provided by Consumer Cellular and by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, a private corporation funded by the American people. And by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Good evening and thank you for joining us. President Donald Trump spent much of today at his Virginia golf club and continued to deny news reports that he has disparaged military service members. The Atlantic, citing anonymous sources, reported on Thursday that the president called Americans who died in war, quote, losers and suckers. He allegedly made the comments while on a 2018 trip to France before a visit to an American military cemetery was canceled. The administration and Mr. Trump say the trip was called off due to a heavy rainstorm. The president denied he made the comments again yesterday at a late afternoon White House news conference.
No, it was a fake story written by a magazine that was probably not going to be around much longer. But it was a totally fake story, and that was confirmed by many people who were actually there.
Yesterday, Fox News correspondent Jennifer Griffin said she confirmed parts of the Atlantic story.
John, I've spoken with two senior U.S. officials who were on the trip to France who confirmed to me key details in the Atlantic article and the quotes attributed to the president. My source, a former Trump administration official, told me when the president spoke about the Vietnam War, he said it was a stupid war. Anyone who went was a sucker.
Mr. Trump said Griffin, quote, should be fired for this kind of reporting. As the U.S. celebrates Labor Day weekend, protests against police violence and racial injustice continued in Rochester, New York, and Portland, Oregon.
All persons must immediately leave the area.
For the 100th straight night, protesters in Portland hit the streets. A gathering near a police union building was declared an unlawful assembly, and police arrested several demonstrators while dispersing the crowd. The fatal shooting of a man affiliated with a right-wing group last weekend and the killing by federal agents of the self-described anti-fascist sought in connection with that killing have further roiled the city. In Rochester, police used tear gas to disperse a crowd protesting the death of Daniel Prude. It was the third straight night of protests since the release of video showing his arrest in March. Prude, a 41-year-old black man, died a week after police put a mesh hood over his head in a COVID-19 safety protocol and then pressed his head into the pavement when he tried to stand. Prude's family said he was suffering from a mental health crisis. All seven officers involved have been suspended with pay as the New York State Attorney General investigates. In Louisville, Kentucky, far-right and self-described militia members gathered for a rally and march this morning. Organizers described it as an event to support police and oppose far-left groups they called domestic terrorists. Hundreds attended, many of them armed, and marched near downtown after a rally at a city park. In the early afternoon, there were some scuffles with counter-protesters. Louisville has been one of the centers of nationwide Black Lives Matter demonstrations since the police killing of 26-year-old Breonna Taylor in March. Louisville Metro police officers shot Taylor while executing a no-knock search warrant. Taylor, who was an EMT, was unarmed. A march demanding the police officers who killed Taylor be arrested and charged is planned for late today near Churchill Downs Racetrack, where the Kentucky Derby is being run this evening without spectators. In Mississippi yesterday, a judge ruled that Curtis Flowers, who was tried 6 times for the same murders, will not be prosecuted for a 7th time. Flowers was convicted multiple times for the 1996 murder of 4 people in a furniture store in Winona, Mississippi, but all the convictions were overturned. He was released from prison last December after serving more than 22 years. The state attorney general's office declined to prosecute Flowers again, citing a lack of evidence and viable witnesses. 2 years ago, an American public media podcast brought national attention to the case and included a recording from one of the key witnesses who recanted his testimony. The U.S. Supreme Court overturned Flowers' most recent conviction last year, citing racial bias in jury selection. The court found the prosecutor who had tried Flowers each time had unconstitutionally kept black Mississippians from serving on the jury. A lawyer for Flowers said the case was, quote, tainted throughout by racial discrimination. It should never have occurred and lasted far too long, but we are glad it's finally over. Health officials are reminding Americans to remain vigilant about the spread of COVID-19 on this long holiday weekend. There are now more than 6.2 million confirmed infections in the U.S. and more than 188,000 deaths. Globally, the death toll from COVID-19 has reached 875,000, with more than 26.6 million confirmed infections, according to researchers at Johns Hopkins University. In India, confirmed infections topped 4 million today, and the country reported a new record in daily cases. India now joins just Brazil and the U.S. in crossing the 4 million mark. The jump to 4 million comes just 13 days after India reached 3 million cases. In Australia, there were protests today against lockdowns in the city of Melbourne. Freedom, freedom, freedom. Melbourne has been under a strict lockdown to prevent a spike in infections, including a nightly curfew. The state of Victoria, which includes Melbourne, reported 11 deaths and 76 new infections today. And in Italy, former Prime Minister Silvio Berlusconi is in stable condition after being hospitalized with COVID-19 on Wednesday. In a statement today, his doctor said there was cautious but reasonable optimism that the 83-year-old will recover. In Belarus, protests continue today calling for the resignation of authoritarian leader Alexander Lukashenko. About 5,000 women marched in Minsk. Police followed, but there were no detentions reported. Belarus has been roiled by protests since the August 9th presidential election, when Lukashenko reportedly won his 6th term with 80% of the vote. Opposition supporters dispute the results and say the vote was rigged. Lukashenko's main rival in that election, Svetlana Tikhanovskaya, fled to neighboring Lithuania and yesterday called on the United Nations to impose sanctions and send a monitoring mission to Belarus. The 2nd typhoon this week is on track to hit southern Japan and South Korea in the next few days. Officials are urging residents of Okinawa and other southern islands to prepare for torrential rains and winds of more than 110 miles per hour ahead of Typhoon Haisen's expected landfall. A typhoon earlier in the week battered South Korea and Japan, injuring dozens of people and cutting power to thousands of homes. Yesterday, a 2nd survivor was rescued after a cargo ship carrying thousands of cattle capsized in that storm on Wednesday. The search for more than 40 other crew members was called off because of the new typhoon. For the latest national news and international news, visit pbs.org/newshour. This week, Facebook and Twitter announced that disinformation campaigns, just like the ones that targeted the 2016 presidential election, are threatening this year's election. As more of these sophisticated campaigns persist, many are spreading rapidly online before social media companies can fact-check and take them down. I recently spoke with Dean Freelong, associate professor at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, about these potential digital election disruptions. Delivering disinformation in politics and political campaigns is really nothing new. What makes it so dangerous and disruptive?
Well, I think disinformation has really been exploding in the digital sphere, right? So this is something that we saw a lot during the 2016 election and something that we're continuing to see now. And I think that in the 2016 election, before, during, and after, this was something that Americans were not necessarily aware of. They didn't really see coming. And now they're a bit more aware of it. But of course, the disinformation has evolved. So as it evolves, it sort of remains ahead of Americans' understanding of it and the perception of it. And that's what really makes it dangerous.
It's savvier now, would you say?
Yes, right. So that if the point of disinformation is to deceive people and to get them to believe or engage in behaviors that they otherwise wouldn't, you can't really be forthright about your identity and what you're talking about. So you have to keep ahead of the media and, of course, of academics like me that are studying it and trying to get to the bottom of it. And the real problem that we encounter is that so much of this can only really be understood in retrospect. So in other words, it's only after the social media companies release the identities of the accounts and the people behind them that we can truly understand what's going on. And that's what really makes it scary, because in the moment, there's really no way to do that.
What is the impact then of this, and how effective is it? How well does it work?
The impact of disinformation should be understood within the broader context of media effects more generally. So I participated in a study that showed that disinformation provided by the Russian Internet Research Agency really didn't change anybody's mind, right? So it wasn't like shifting, you know, left wing to right wing or anything like that. So that's pretty definitive. And other accounts have also suggested this is not the way that disinformation typically works. If it has any effects at all, what it typically does is it pushes people further along the direction that they're already in. So if you're left, it maybe makes you more left. If you're right, it maybe pushes you more to the right. There needs to be more research on that, but we know that it does not result in this sort of, you know, major opinion shifts that sometimes is out there propagated in popular accounts of this type of phenomenon.
Does it have a disproportionate impact on any segment of the population?
Yes. So we know that there have been certain segments of the population that have been disproportionately targeted. We know that in the case of the Russian Internet Research Agency, that white conservatives and black protesters on the left were disproportionately targeted in 2016 and afterward. And this, of course, follows along with the disinformation playbook, where you target the most vulnerable and the most the populations that are most likely to engage with this kind of content, and where the impact is likely to be the greatest.
You said we're seeing more of it, savvier now than in 2016. Is more of it also based on stereotypical themes?
Yes. I mean, this is one of the areas of the fissures in American life that foreign-based disinformation actors like to exploit the most. And so race has been a major sort of flashpoint for that. You know, immigration is another one. And so these kinds of hot-button issues are really ripe for disinformation exploitation.
How easy, how hard is it to detect? And the reason I ask that is because the New York Times is reporting this week that there's some Russian troll agency, some agent of the Kremlin, that has been hiring American freelance journalists to work for something called Peace Data or Peace Research or something like that. And the folks who are being hired don't know that they're working for the Russians, and they're going out and spreading disinformation.
Right. And so this is part of that evolution that I'm talking about. So primarily in 2016 and immediately after, it was mostly Russian agents, people who are sort of Russian speakers, at least we know that, that were engaging in this. And so the recruitment of actual Americans is really the next evolution of that. And, you know, who better to pretend to be Americans, or who better to represent foreign interests than Americans themselves, right? They're less suspect because they're some of us, right? And so absolutely, I think this is part of that next evolution that I was talking about, making it much more difficult to detect. Even the people that are carrying these messages forward can't detect it. They don't know necessarily that they're engaging in it. They're just collecting a paycheck. And of course, at the moment of economic precarity that we're at, you know, there may not be too many questions asked about where that money is coming from if you're desperate to get some of that.
In 2016, I remember I was presented with something that someone apparently got from Facebook, and it was about Hillary Clinton and the child trafficking and all this stuff. And then I asked, okay, where did that come from? And someone told me the source. I immediately did not recognize it as anything worthy, anything credible. So that then raises the question for me then, how do we, as the targets of these disinformation campaigns, how do we separate fiction from fact?
Part of the issue that we run into is that it's extremely difficult to do so until after the fact, because we have to rely on these social media companies to disclose the identities, or at least the social media handles, of the disinformation actors. But one thing I tell my students is that you really need to understand that disinformation plays upon your pre-existing political biases, right? So it plays on confirmation bias and motivated reasoning, which means that when people are really trying to appeal to you with disinformation, they're going to try to say things and do things that are going to attack people that you already don't like and support people that you do like. And so that, I think, is where people should really pay attention. When it's something that seems to be too good to be true, that's attacking something that you don't like, or that's in support of somebody you do like, that raises the possibility that people are really trying to engage in a disinformation style attack on you. And this may be from somebody that you know, or an organization that you're aware of, or from a source that you are not familiar with. But when it's really going overboard in support of your political beliefs, that raises the possibility. It's not definitive proof, but it really should put people on high alert that they may be on the receiving end of a disinformation attack.
Associate Professor Dean Freeland of University of North Carolina on disinformation in our political system. Professor, thank you very much for joining us.
Okay, thanks a lot.
This past week, New York City's Metropolitan Museum of Art and the Museum of Modern Art reopened to the public. It's a positive development for one of the economic sectors hit hardest by the COVID-19 pandemic. According to the Brookings Institute, since the pandemic hit, the creative economy has lost 2.7 million jobs, nearly a third of its workforce. But as restrictions are beginning to lift in some places, the arts are also starting to return to life. NewsHour Weekend's Yvette Feliciano visited one area in Western Massachusetts where patrons are experiencing the arts in person for the first time in almost 6 months.
It's summer in Pittsfield, the largest city in Berkshire County, Massachusetts, and tonight's audience is about to see something they probably haven't seen in months, live theater. Since the COVID-19 pandemic hit, the Stage Actors Union Actors Equity Association has only approved two theaters to resume live performances in the U.S. Both of them were in the Berkshires. The first was Barrington Stage Company, which staged the one-man show Harry Clark in early August. The second, Berkshire Theater Group, is now performing the musical Godspell through September 20th. For that company's artistic director, Kate McGuire, the show marks a bright spot in a chaotic year. The normally vibrant theater community here has been in turmoil since Massachusetts shut down non-essential workplaces due to COVID-19.
We closed up on March 11th. Everybody went home. And then we recognized that we're in the business of putting on live theater, and that our industry is at a complete standstill.
The actors in Berkshire Theater Group's Godspell talk about their dilemma at the beginning of the play.
The COVID-19 pandemic took away everything I worked my whole life for. I felt alone, abandoned, unessential, and just completely unnecessary.
My entire business relies on human connection.
When theater shut down, so did I.
I don't know how our industry is going to survive. Is there going to be money from the federal government, from the NEA, to the state arts councils? How are we going to survive this? We can't do any of our work at all.
That's not just a problem for theater companies here. The Berkshires relies heavily on the arts to help drive tourism, which in 2018 brought in over $467 million and supported almost 4,000 jobs. And it isn't just theaters being affected.
Museums like the Clark Art Institute in Williamstown, Massachusetts, also closed its doors in March.
Nevertheless, museum staff continued working. Olivier Mele is the Clark's director.
Part of the staff went to work on different sort of tasks. Some of them were, for example, helping to redo the website when in fact they were supposed to welcome the public. Some others were preparing reopening very, very early on.
And then on July 6th, Massachusetts entered phase 3 of its reopening plan, which included museums. Less than a week later, the Clark opened its doors again. For now, visitors and staff must wear masks at all times. The museum has also reduced admission to 25% capacity on their 140-acre campus, and all tickets must be purchased in advance for specific entry times.
We are now at 300 people in a day. It's also easier to keep them scattered all over the museum if you have less people.
Live outdoor performances are now also allowed in Massachusetts. With the approval of Actors Equity, union actors are now performing in the Berkshires, even as Broadway remains dark.
The actors quarantined for 2 weeks before they came. They got tested right before they arrived here. We went to New York with vans and picked them all up so they were all together. They've been in what we call a bubble ever since. They all live in the same house. They don't ever leave their bubble.
Artistic director Kate McGuire says Godspell is particularly relevant during the pandemic.
It's about a group of people that come together. They're all in different places of chaos, asking the question, how did we get here? How are we going to get through this period in time? And by the end of the play, there's some connection and understanding of essentially what it means to be human. God save the people. Oh, God save the
people. To protect the audience, the company spaces the seats out in groups of two or three.
The audience is under this tent, all in masks, socially distanced, is 25 feet from the first row to the artists on the stage. And as you can see, there's partitions up on the stage so that when the actors are singing, those partitions are moved. So we eliminate some of the spray from reaching out.
Not everything has gone smoothly with the reopening.
In early August, due to an uptick in COVID cases, Massachusetts Governor Charlie Baker lowered the limit on outdoor gatherings from 100 people to 50.
Because of this, Berkshire Theater Group had to reduce their seating capacity. Despite the challenges, both Mele and McGuire are committed to an in-person experience with art during this time.
There is the wind, there is the sun, there is plenty of sensorial aspect of art that are embedded in an in-person visit. I think the in-person aspect of the relationship, the experience with art is essential. When you are in front of the work of art, there is a moment, there is a pose, there is something which is very unique and it's very different from being virtual.
It's a completely different experience. People go to church, or they're sitting out on front lawns of church now to be together, to experience their faith. And I've always said that my church is here at my theater.
McGuire says that giving people that experience is important now more than ever.
Artists' lives are being destroyed around the country right now. I mean, for so many artists, at least when they're not working, they can wait on tables. They can't even wait on tables right now. So we need to remember the artist and how they impact our world, and what would the world look like without art.
You better start! You better start! You better start to learn your lessons well.
That's all for this edition of PBS NewsHour Weekend. For the latest news updates, visit pbs.org/newshour. I'm Michael Hill. Thanks for watching and have a good night.
PBS NewsHour Weekend is made possible by Sue and Edgar Wackenheim III, the Anderson Family Fund, Bernard and Denise Schwartz, the Cheryl and Philip Milstein Family, Barbara Hope Zuckerberg, Charles Rosenblum, We try to live in the moment to not miss what's right in front of us. At Mutual of America, we believe taking care of tomorrow can help you make the most of today. Mutual of America Financial Group, retirement services and investments.
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular's goal has been to provide wireless service that helps people communicate and connect. We offer a variety of no-contract plans, and our U.S.-based customer service team can help find one that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
Additional support has been provided by and by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, a private corporation funded by the American people, and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.